We are on Understanding the Kingdom, Part 35. And I'm going to entitle this session, In Hell, the Day That All Heaven Broke Loose. If you have your Bibles today, I want to go to Luke chapter 16, verses 19 through 31. And we're not going to read this whole section of Scripture simply because we got a lot of other things that I want to cover today. But in this story that Jesus tells, this is not a parable. In all parables, Jesus would never name anybody. He would say there was once a man and that he did this, or there was once a woman and she did that, and it was a parable. In this, the Scripture clearly does not state that this was a parable. He does not honor the rich man as to give him any glory by giving him a name. But he does Lazarus, the poor man. And I think one of the reasons was because where he gave this teaching, everybody knew who Lazarus was. And he gave honor to the poor man and not to the rich man, because the poor man tried to honor God in his life and ended up in Abraham's bosom. But when you read this story, one of the things that begins to unfold is the Hebraic understanding of a place called Sheol. That in Sheol, there was the lower part of Sheol that we call hell. And there was this gulf in between Abraham's bosom. And all those who died waiting for Messiah that remained faithful to the covenant of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, that remained faithful to that covenant, when they died, they didn't go to heaven. They went to Abraham's bosom, and they waited there with Abraham, which I think is so significant because we've already covered how that Abraham was willing to give his son of promise on an altar for God, which then opened the door for his covenant partner, Almighty God, to go to the same spot 2,000 years later and offer his only begotten son for the redemption of mankind as the ultimate Passover lamb. And so they were there in Abraham's bosom waiting for the Lamb of God, the Lamb that Abraham prophesied that Almighty God would provide, waited for that to come. And so we're going to get into a lot of things today, but when we understand the placement of this and that this concept of Sheol was verified by Jesus, this was not a story. He was verifying what was going on and brought someone that they knew and showed. I mean, there are several things in the story. Number one, showed us there was a gulf that those in the lower part of Sheol could never go up into Abraham's bosom. Showed that there was a place of torment. And even goes as far as to rebuking the rich man and said, even if somebody rose from the dead, they would not believe him because they would not believe Moses. I mean, there's a lot of powerful truths to this story, but this sets the scene for us to understand what happened after Jesus died on the cross. He did not go to heaven when he died. In fact, he does not ascend to heaven until after his resurrection, which we're going to get into in the next session, because there's so much I want to deal with this one. He goes into Sheol, and it was the day that heaven broke loose in hell. Now, his torment, what we got into last week, that even the bulls of Bashan is talked about in Psalms 22. Og, one of the giants, was called the Bull of Bashan. And so all of hell showed up for the crucifixion of Christ. It wasn't just the fallen angels, but every Nephilim spirit on the planet descended and watched the Son of God die. And the people around them begin to become nothing more than mouthpieces for the council of hell to mock Almighty God dying on the cross. In fact, the word goes on to say after his resurrection through the Apostle Paul, if they would have known, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. And so I want to get in today some of the things that the Word of God shares with us that happened in it. It's in snippets. It's not like folding out like in the Gospels, but it's throughout the New Testament. And the first place I want to go is Hebrews chapter 1, verses 8 through 13. Can you imagine for a minute, let's set the stage for this. Jesus dies on the cross. In fact, he even took authority over his own death. It said he gave up the ghost. He chose when he was going to die, and he only died when he knew all things were fulfilled. And so now he's being escorted in to the lower parts of hell. And the devil thinks he's going to be able to have his way with him, but the moment that he gets down there, heaven begins to speak. And it's recorded here in Hebrews chapter 1, starting in verse 8. And to the Son he says, "Your throne, O God, lasts forever and ever. A scepter of righteousness is the scepter of your kingdom. You have loved righteousness and hated wickedness. Therefore, God, your God, has anointed you with the oil of gladness more than your companions. And you, Lord, laid the foundation of the earth in the beginning, and the heavens are the work of your hands. They will perish, but you remain, and they will all wear out like a garment. As the cloak, you will fold them up, and they will be changed. But you are the same, and your years will not end. And to which of the angels did he say at any time, 'Sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool'?" And when that was spoken in hell, there was an uh-oh that will ring throughout all of eternity, and hell knew they had a problem. They thought that they had circumvented and killed the one that was going to crush the Nehesh's head. And they thought it was all going to happen during his earthly ministry. I imagine that all of hell was watching for him to raise up as Messiah ben David, as the conquering king to begin to conquer the earth. And they thought the moment that they killed him, that they had won, and now he was going to be in Sheol, and basically trapped where nothing else can happen. They get him down there, and all of a sudden from heaven, "You just won. Your kingdom is going to last forever. You're the one that created it all." At that moment, the light came on for Lucifer, but it was too late. Could you imagine the screeches and the screams that filled hell for the first time? And it was not the torment of human souls. It began to be the torment of their keepers. Let's go to Colossians chapter 2, verses 13 through 15. Now, I thank the Apostle Paul, and I believe personally, I believe Hebrews was penned by the Apostle Paul. There is evidence, some commentators believe, that at one time it was connected to the book of Galatians. What we call the book of Galatians was written to try to correct the error that the Shammai Pharisees had done teaching salvation through circumcision to the Gentiles. And then the book of Hebrews was connected to it to bring correction to the Shammai Pharisees, showing that Jesus was a more excellent way than that which had been established through Moses. That's why there is no authorship, because at one time they were connected together. And so the reason I say this is because we need to understand what we call the Pauline revelation is more than just the Gentiles being able to come into the kingdom, because that revelation did not begin with the Apostle Paul. That began with Peter in Cornelius' home, where he went back to Jerusalem all freaked out and said, "Well, what can I say? They all got the Holy Ghost and began speaking in other tongues and prophesying." I mean, it was just like the day of Pentecost. Except it was all these Gentiles. So, you know, God's bringing them in. Paul, when he was taken up to the third heaven, that's where he got the Pauline revelation. He was back on the backside of the desert for 3 years. Jesus began teaching him. And by the way, we also know that from modern research, it takes 3 years to rewire your brain. And so as he was praying and studying the Word for 3 years before he launched his ministry to the Gentiles, I believe it was during that time that he was caught up into the third heaven and he was taught by Jesus. And so Jesus said, let me show you what happened here. Let me show you what happened when I went down to hell. Let me show you what happened on these things. And so Paul, every once in a while, will feed and give us a glimpse of that revelation that he got when it was pertinent to the things that he was teaching. And so we find that in the book of Hebrews. I think we also find it here in Colossians chapter 2, verses 13 through 15. He said, "And you, being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh, he has resurrected together with him, having forgiven you all sins. He blotted out the handwriting of the ordinance that was against you and contrary to you, and he took it out of the way, nailing it to the cross, and that was not the Torah." Number one, it was all of our offenses that we had done to God. How many know hell kept a record of every sin that you have ever done? Hell keeps a record. Satan, the Bible tells us, Lucifer goes, and he is the accuser of the brethren. And in the Greek, that literally paints the picture of him being a prosecuting attorney saying, hell has a right to do this in Mike Lake's life because he did this, and he did this, and he did this, and he did this. But when I accept Christ, Almighty God takes that long laundry list the devil has of everything he's planted into your life to trip you up, and he nails it to the cross. And what the Apostle Paul, the words he uses here, literally is paid in full is written across that. So that's what he's talking about here. And ordinances do not refer to the laws of the Torah. It refers to the laws of who can come into the temple or not. It's a special section dealing with ceremonial law and all these different things. He nailed it to the cross. Now listen here, verse 15, this you need to underline in your Bible. "And having disarmed authorities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them by the cross." Now this paints a picture. This is, well, let's say when Caesar would come into an area that they would conquer, they would take the kings and everyone else that they allowed to survive, and they would parade them through the streets of where they reigned, saying that they have been unthroned, their authority has been taken away, that the new king is now ruling and reigning. That's the verbiage the Apostle Paul shares, that when Jesus went down to hell, he loosed a bunch of hell on the devil. So for the first time, hell itself was being tormented. And then he paraded them through the corridors of hell itself, saying, "I am the triumphant king. My kingdom will last forever and ever," just like we saw in the book of Hebrews. At that moment, he crushed the power of the serpent's head. He provided a remedy. The cross. So there's so much talk today about singularity. And one of the things that is concerning me, I'm going to have to ride on, is the new 5G network they're doing with the global brain they're trying to set up. Kurzweil, one of the authorities on this singularity, talking about when AI or artificial intelligence achieves sentience and they become smarter than us. He used to put that around 2045. Now, since they have announced with OneWeb everything they're doing, this in the last couple of weeks has moved it to 2029. I mean, just globally, okay? So we're a whole lot closer than we could ever believe. But Jesus is greater than all that technology. He is greater. Greater is he that is in me than anything in the world, to include the watchers, their technology, or anything else. This needs to be drilled into the hearts and the minds of God's people, that there are levels of spiritual technology that we have had some in the past just kind of brush up against, like Lester Sumrall, Smith Wigglesworth, have brushed up against, that God is getting ready to release knowledge. In Daniel, it talks about in the last days that knowledge will increase and men will run to and fro in the earth. In the Hebrew, it's the knowledge. And so that could be taken two different ways, the knowledge of the watchers or the knowledge of the kingdom that no other generation has walked in, because there was never a greater threat than what we're going to have in the days ahead. But Jesus is greater. The cross is a singularity as well. It changed history. It not only changed history, it transformed humanity that would embrace the reality of the cross. That when I embrace the reality of the cross and accept the sacrifice, I am born again, that my spirit man is now connected to the third heaven, that Almighty God just outdone what happened in the garden when man fell. I went from being dead to being alive. Because my relationship was reestablished with the throne of God. Oh, I mean, this stuff's good. If God could just open up our eyes and see Him parading principalities and powers and rulers of darkness and Lucifer himself and all the council of the gates of hell, He paraded them around hell itself, showing that He was greater, that He was the conquering king, and now they were the lackeys as far as His kingdom is concerned. We have more victory than we understand. Our problem is the enemy keeps us so caught up in life and all the things of distraction that the world has to give us that we don't dig in and find out who we are and what we can walk in. It's not automatic. You got to walk in it, you got to cultivate it, and you've got to learn to grow in it. That's what this generation has missed. In fact, I saw this morning on one of my videos somebody griping about, you know, why do all these men of God have to write books? So that just in case the Lord tarries, that you guys can stand on our shoulders and take it another level. See, that's what a lot of this generation has forgotten. One of the reasons I have all these books, and this is just a small fraction of what I have, is I want to learn from what previous generations have learned from the Word of God. I need to stand on the shoulders of Andrew Murray and D.L. Moody or Pember and so many others. Even the Apostle Paul, while he was in prison, called for some of his books from his own personal library to be taken to him to help him in his research. One of the things, and I know videos like this are important, but I can't footnote and document all the research that I have done properly in a video. That's why books are so important. Did they go back to the original sources? Or are they quoting somebody that quoted somebody that quoted somebody that quoted somebody that quoted somebody? And there have been a lot of times in my own research in documenting the footnotes, I find out they're actually saying the opposite of what the original content of that passage was. Because it got twisted over the years and nobody goes back to the original text or the original book. And they're not quoting whatever scholar that they're saying that they're quoting. They're quoting what somebody else said he said instead of what he said. And I have found, especially since the turn of the 20th century, people will misquote them to make a man of the previous generation's words. They bend them to make them say what they wanted to say, thinking that we're too lazy to go back and find out what the guy actually said. That's one of the reasons I have a library, because we have to. A library, there's two of the best friends of any minister, and if you're a minister, you listen to me. Your two best friends is the Holy Spirit and your personal library. That's where you got to dig and research. That's where the gold is found. That's just another pet peeve of mine, but guys, we are an illiterate generation that is going to face things that the apostles never faced. The early church didn't have to face watchers or advanced technology. The most advanced technology they had to face was the end of a Roman sword. That was it. There's so much more available to us. Now let's go to Matthew chapter 28. One of the things that Jesus said, one of the reasons He came is to seek that which was lost. And we always think about that as just being men. Now, how many know that I'm glad that Jesus came to seek us out who were lost. But in the garden, it was not only man that was lost. It was the authority and the dominion that he gave man. And what's interesting is when you read it in context, and a lot of scholars will do this, there's a concept that when God gave dominion to Adam in the garden, it was kind of like a lease. That after a certain amount of time, it runs out. Just like if you lease a building or whatever. And so they have known that, and I think that's one of the reasons why Lucifer also knows his time is short, because he stole authority that had a time limit to it. But at the same time, how many know when you start dealing with the owner, that he can, when you start dealing with from an owner's perspective, he can supersede the tenant's authority? Because even encoded within that, what we see in the first three books of Genesis is that Adam was always responsible to God. It wasn't carte blanche. It was, I'm the head, you're going to take care of the garden, you're going to follow my orders, I'm going to give you instructions. Satan stole that, so he stole the authority that he uses that to become the God, little g, of this world. Now listen to the words of Jesus after he resurrected. Picking up in verse 17, and when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and earth. Now that was something he didn't say before the cross. It was after the cross. He went down and got the authority back, because it was there that he crushed the serpent's head. Oh, if hell would only knew that the weight of the cross that was sticking in the ground would one day, just within hours, end up on the top of their head. Now, if you've ever lived in the country, if you've had a rake or a hoe, and there's a snake in the yard, that rake or hoe will find its way to the head of that snake. And what the devil never planned on is that Almighty God would use the cross. It was God's hoe in his garden to crush the enemy's head. All authority has been given to me in heaven and earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things which I have commanded you. Now we need to take this in context. Jesus is the one who gave the commandments to Moses on Mount Sinai. Jesus, or the pre-incarnate Christ, he's the Aleph Tav. He's the one that we see throughout the entire Old Testament. He is Yahweh. And so all of this, he's the one who brought down Egypt. He's the one who conquered Pharaoh. He's the one who parted the Red Sea. All of this was Jesus and Jesus alone. Because only through him can anyone know the Father. That is something that is universal from the very beginning. What I read in Hebrews, you're the one that created everything. It was by your hands that was created. Therefore, all this dominion goes to you. He is the one, the Aleph Tav is the one, Yahweh Elohim, which is encoded within his name. The first and second coming of Messiah is encoded in Yahweh Elohim. He came, he made man out of the dust of the earth, and it was the breath of Messiah, the breath of Jesus, that brought man to life. Because he was always the aspect of God that we would know, that we would be familiar with, and that would redeem us back. Powerful stuff, isn't it? And now he's saying, because of the cross, I'm restoring your relationship the way that you had with the Father, so that you can begin moving in this authority. And now you go and you're empowered by my Spirit to teach men all the things I have commanded you. And that includes the things in the Torah. There's a few things. How many know that the Levites aren't functioning today, that Jesus is the sacrifice? For Passover, we didn't have to sacrifice a lamb. We didn't have to make an offering burnt by fire, because he is that sacrifice. He is the unleavened bread come down from heaven. All of this is him. And now everything that is being done on the inside of us. That's why Mary and I always preach that, you know, quit going through your house. If you would spend half the time, you go through your house looking for leaven in your cabinets and you begin seeking it out in your heart. Maybe God could restore your family and you would get that religious spirit that's hanging off of you the size of a gorilla. Come on now. Because the kingdom of God is within. Our problem is none of us have worked on building the kingdom of God within, and it's about the size of a marble. Because we've been too busy with the things of the world. But Jesus is saying here, listen, all authority is given to me in heaven and earth. Therefore, I'm now giving you authority to go and teach men to walk in my ways, to see them set free by the power of the cross, to lead them into the kingdom, and then to teach them the commandments of the kingdom so that you can walk free of this other kingdom while you're in the earth. Because he got victory over them for us. But he didn't stop there. Let's go to Revelation chapter 1, verses 17 through 19. You know, sometimes we read over things and we don't necessarily, sometimes it doesn't really dawn on us what's there. I mean, have ever done that with Scripture? You read over the same Scripture 1,000 times, and the 1,001st time, the Holy Spirit goes, ding, and God opens your eyes, and you say, I don't know how I ever had not seen that in the past. Who put that in there? Yeah. Verse 17, when I saw him, I fell at his feet as though I were dead, and then he laid his hand on me, saying to me, do not be afraid, I am the first and the last. I'm the Aleph and the Tav. I am he who lives, was dead, and look, I am alive forevermore. Amen. I mean, Jesus was so excited about it. He had to stop and give it a little amen as he was doing it. So be it. Jesus starts talking about what he did, even Jesus starts having church. And I have the keys of Hades and of death. Write these things which you have seen, things which are, and the things which will take place after this. He had the keys. He got the keys back. Notice the sequence even in which he reveals it. I am he who was alive, though I was dead, and look, I'm alive forevermore, and when I resurrected, I got the keys with me. Hell no longer has the keys. Death no longer has the keys. Oh, you don't know the power of that. If Jesus has the keys of death, that means he can also unlock the resurrection. Whew. That will preach. He has the keys. In fact, we read later on in the book of Revelation, he takes one of those little keys off the key ring and gives it to an angel who goes up and binds up Lucifer and throws him in the bottomless pit for 1,000 years so that we can have the millennial reign. How many know those keys are important? He had the keys. Heaven has everything it needs to wrap this thing up. We're just waiting for time to finish up, that lease to finish up, and for us to get the job done that we're supposed to do. And I think one of them, we go back to where he said, all authority has been given to me, now you go and you teach. We have never really defined what our priesthood is, and we've not walked in our priesthood. We are priests and soldiers in the kingdom of God. All of us. But what we have done is we have relegated it to the fivefold ministry and says, you be that, and we'll give up a little offering of praise, and we don't even understand what the priesthood is about. And it's more than just offering up praise. We got to deal with the word, the name, the authority, the blood, and the fire. Oh, everybody know I'm heading to Dallas this week, and I can't wait to get down there. That fat man got up in there and just exploded 9 different ways. Let's go a little bit further. Let's go to Ephesians chapter 4, verses 7 through 10. I don't know about you, but I'm having fun. There's a Jewish document that John G. Lake got a hold of and paid great expense to get it. And I've got it somewhere here in my archive. And it was a story of a man, when Jesus resurrected, how many know he wasn't alone in the resurrection? He had the keys. He unlocked hell, and he unlocked death, and he emptied Abraham's bosom. And the days that he was on the earth, the 40 days, all these people were walking around the streets of Jerusalem and finding their loved ones and saying, you won't disbelieve what happened down in Abraham's bosom. And one of them got written down. And it talked about this war, this momentary war that went on in hell, and how that the glorious one came over and was the only one ever in history to cross that chasm that could not be crossed. And spent 3 days preaching and fellowshipping with them before he emptied it out. We're getting ready to find that right here in Ephesians chapter 4, verses 7 through 10. But grace was given to each one of us according to the measure of the gift of Christ. Therefore, he says, when he ascended on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts to men, saying he ascended. What does it mean but that he also descended first into the lower parts of the earth? And he who descended is also the one who ascended far above the heavens, that he might fulfill all things. He went down there, he emptied out, he preached to those that were captive in Abraham's bosom. He preached to them what he had done and fellowshipped with them for 3 days. And when he resurrected, they all went with him. They all went with him. And this is declared in Matthew chapter 27. Verses 52 and 53, when it's talking about the resurrection of Messiah. And it says, the graves were also opened, and many bodies of the saints who had died were risen. And coming out of the grave after his resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many. Uncle Bob! You died 15 years ago. Yeah, but I'm better now. Let me tell you a little story. Some of these stories were documented by the Jewish community. And so there were the 40 days that Jesus ministered after his resurrection. There were a bunch of others that resurrected out of Abraham's bosom. Kind of wondered if some of them didn't know that they were talking to Abraham or David, Jeremiah, Isaiah. The Bible tells us in Acts that when he ascended, He was met with a great cloud of witness. That was all the saints that had emptied out Abraham's bosom and met him in the air. You see, there's another meeting in the air that's coming. When that final trump has sounded, all of us that have died in waiting for him will be resurrected. Paul had to cover, say, listen, the rapture or the apazo, the catching away, is not going to affect. There's another resurrection coming because he still has the key. And there's going to be another great cloud of witness. There's going to be the great union when we get up there. Abraham's going to say, glad to have you as part of the party. Oh. It's a powerful thing, and we're so close to it. It is a powerful thing. But how many know we have a job to do between now and then? One of the things that is one of my pet peeves are what I call Christian parkers. They come and park on their bench waiting for the rapture. We're also going to find out in the next session. I keep on going. I'm sharing. I'm going to have to, but we'll document all this. As they're waiting, as they're looking at Jesus ascending, and they say he'll not come back until certain things take place. The restoration of all things. That's our job. He's waiting for his enemies to be made his footstool, and those that are a part of the remnant, a part of the elect, to come into the kingdom and to mature. It's not just getting them saved, but it's we have got to do our job to help them walk in the kingdom and for us to quit playing church and quit being religious and start. We are a part of a kingdom. I hold two citizenships. The first is to the kingdom of God, and it trumps everything else. And then secondarily, I'm a citizen of the United States of America. But we have never worked on building the kingdom within. We have never worked on fully becoming who we're supposed to be in Messiah. And we've allowed the devil to keep us locked up when the shackles that he has in our lives since we've been saved are nothing more than paper. But we won't do the homework that we need to realize that and to break through and to be free the way that we're supposed to be free. Because his greatest fear is we're going to learn who we are and get dedicated into growing up into who we are, and hell will not be able to hold us back. That's the whole purpose I do everything that I do. I always go back to Daniel that even when the Antichrist is at his zenith, there will be those that are passionate about their God and will do great exploits in the middle of the iniquity force being stronger than it has ever been in history. It won't hold back God's people for doing what they're supposed to do. And if it won't hold it back then, what's our excuse now? Oh, man. We have allowed the enemy to convince us that we're wimps when God's made us to be champions in the kingdom for his cause. It's time for us to get in the Word and to be transformed by the renewing of our mind, to discover who we are and how to serve our great King, and to be his hands, his feet, his voice in the earth until he comes back. Father God, we just thank you for the Word. Father, we thank you that it will not return to you void, but will accomplish work until you have sent it. And Father, I ask for everyone that watches this video, everyone that's here, Father, that we would have a determination that we're not going to let hell hold us back any longer, that we are going to learn who we are in Christ, that we are going to learn how to keep the commandments by the power of the Holy Spirit, and to do it in balance as we examine everything within your Word, so that Jesus would be glorified, because, Father, that is the witness. Coming into the kingdom and begin walking in it with a fresh fire in our hearts and a determination to honor Messiah in all things. And Father, we just thank you and we praise you for it all. In Jesus' name.